Yeah, so that's a perfect definition, okay? Times are nodes or numbers with exactly two divisors. And when we say two divisors, they are not the same. Right?
You get a lecture from the chair today?
But we did prove that there are infinitely many primes, right?
Did we?
I don't think we proved it, but I thought we just said.
So why are there infinitely many primes?
Well, you can't define a sequence to you know, to like a closed form thing to determine primes. So I mean, you assume that they just keep going, right? You can't build a generator for primes.
There's something people refer to it as a prime generating machine. If you only had finitely many primes, multiply all of them, add one.
Are you multiplying them by some kind of factor and then adding one? Is that what you're doing to the prime?
You take the product of all the primes.
Sure.
Add one.
To get a new prime.
So it's not going to be divided by
that number is not divisible by any of the primes that you started out with. Because if you divide, you always get a remainder one. So if you thought 3 and 5 were the only primes, you take 3 times 5 plus 1 would be 16. So 16 would not be divisible by 3
or
and not divisible by 5. If those are all the primes, then 16 would be a prime.
The remainder is 1 in each of those cases, yeah?
But does that generate all prime numbers?
No, it's not
no,
a generator.
It just, generates
it just says the number of primes is not finite.
How does that prove though, that the number is not finite? You know what I mean? By just saying, just multiply all those and then you know you get something and add one.
Suppose the number is finite.
Sure.
Then you can find a number that is not divisible by any of them, right? If you had already all primes, that number would be a prime. But it's not divisible by any of the primes.
Yeah.
So if you had the list of all primes, that number will be a
not
prime.
On that list.
Right.
Yeah.
So we have infinitely many primes. The second observation was maybe that every natural number is a product of primes.
That's where you get your prime factorization, and every natural number will be able to be expressed as a product of primes.
We don't yet talk about uniqueness.
Okay.
So. That's complete induction. It's not simple induction, it's complete induction. So you take the number, you assume that up to a certain point, all numbers are products of primes. Then you take the next one. It's divisible by any prime. You have it written as a product of smaller numbers. Maybe.
Not sophisticated enough to follow.
Natural number is got a lot of primes. Proved by that.
When you say complete induction, you mean that the one they call the strong principle?
Right. So,
you just take it as definition in those cases.
But if you like 2, 3, doesn't matter. So you assume all m smaller equal to m are products of primes. Then shape m plus 1. No prime divides it. Then it's a prime, right?
Sure.
And if n less or equal to m and n divides m plus 1, then m plus 1 is n times k, and n k are smaller equal to m, and products of primes. So m being the product of those, this is a product of primes, this is a product of primes. So m plus 1 is a product of primes. So you need that any number smaller or equal to m is a product of primes. That's what we are using here. N and k are products of primes. So in that sense, complete induction, because you don't assume that only the specific number is a product of primes, but all the numbers that are smaller or equal to m are products of primes. Yes?
So 7 is a natural number, and that's also a product of primes?
7 is prime.
So
7 is 7. 7 is a product of 1 of 9.
Yeah. 7 to the first power, something like that?
We don't even refer to exponents.
Yeah.
So 7 is a product of 1 prime, right? Then I was making advertisement for one other proposition. Usually I prove it at least 3 times and put it on every exam, so maybe you haven't seen it yet. So, lemma.
Lemma.
Called, named after Euclid. Let P be a prime, and P divides A times B, then P divides A or P divides A. Do you remember the proof?
Proof for what? For the lemma? Isn't that just a property that you're stating from chapter 3 or something like that? Where if you're given that P divides A or B, A times B, then you can split it
they
like that?
They probably prove it or they postpone the proof until something later.
Oh.
But it's definitely proved someplace in the book.
Isn't it just because if P divides A and B, and they're all real numbers, and it has to, by property of real numbers, it has to divide one of them.
Well, probably.
Well, I don't know. It's just, I thought it was just how real numbers work.
You just write it out, just from right there. P divides A times B, so.
P divides A. You got that, right?
Okay.
Case A's 2. Cool. P divides B.
P does not divide A. Then, the greatest common divisor of P and A is
1.
Is that you?
1, right?
1, yeah.
I mean, P only has 2 divisors.
Yeah. 1 and P.
1 and P. So if P was the greatest common divisor, then it would divide A, right?
Yeah.
But we assume it does not. And that's the part that we may have to get back to. Then, 1 is m times a plus n times p. So the greatest common divisor.
Yeah, you showed this to us before.
Yeah, sure. And I wasn't planning to show you this one again. But this lemma I wanted to do. So then, if we multiply this with B, So this is divisible by P. That's my conclusion. Divisible by P, right? A P divides A times P. That's my assumption. Suppose P divides A times P. P divides this, right?
Because P is a factor in there. So what you're saying there is the number is a product of numbers.
Of primes.
Oh.
So the first thing is if the prime divides a product,
sure,
it divides one of the factors.
Yeah, at least, right?
Okay. So here we had two. We can break this up into smaller ones and then it must divide one. And if the prime, if each of them is a prime, so if this prime divides one of those primes, then it must be the prime. So that I was saying that P is one of the ones.
So you're going to represent your number as a product of primes. That's what your Q1 through Q2
That's is. What I want to do in a moment, right? So if we want to get the unique prime factorization, and I never figured out how to formulate this perfect. Every integer, why every natural number? Is a product of primes. And it is so in only one way. Because if I say every natural number has a unique prime factorization, then it doesn't mean that the prime factorization has to be unique.
So can you repeat that?
If I say that every natural number has a unique prime factorization, then it does not mean that the prime factorization of that natural number is unique.
So you can have different prime factorizations of the number?
What I'm saying is somebody could come along and say, so take your integer, check whether it's divisible by 2, and divide it by 2 times something else. Repeat, check whether the remaining part is divisible by 2. Next, try 3, then 5, and so on. So you always try to find the smallest prime factor. That does not exclude the possibility that there is a different prime factorization. The statement here is no matter how you factor it in primes, don't take any recipe, just say it's a product of primes, the prime factor.
Can you give an example?
Well, because of the uniqueness, there isn't much of an example. I mean, 15 is 3 times 5, right?
Yeah.
You can't write it differently as a column of primes.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Every natural number can only be expressed in one way as a product of primes.
So why is it only in one way?
Because they're prime numbers, you know what I mean? You can't decompose the prime and write it in a different way. You're going to get that same batch of numbers, you know what I mean?
That's, we have not proved that yet. We are in the process of. That's what they indoctrinate you with in school.
In elementary school?
Yeah.
Show us the tree.
Well, maybe not, maybe middle school. Not elementary, right? The word prime doesn't show up in elementary. Okay, so let's so proof. By induction, okay. You take n. So this is certainly true for up to 10 or whatever. Okay.
Would you use the corollary over there?
Yeah, I would.
Yeah.
So write n as a product of primes. As product of primes. So if you like, you take n, which is one up to pk, but also allow a q1 up to qr. Two prime factorizations.
Mm-hmm. Proof by contradiction, or by induction, the same.
So, p1 divides n, right?
Yep.
Hence, E1 is QJ. Or some J, right?
In that, between 1 and R.
Right.
Keep going.
And then we have P2 through PK is Q1 QJ hat QR, and hat means omitted.
Okay.
So, these numbers are smaller now. So this is maybe some n prime. That's a smaller number.
Than the original n?
It has prime decompositions. For any prime, the prime decomposition is unique. So these factors are exactly those except this one. And P1 is by QJ. So that's the proof that in the natural numbers, prime factorizations are unique. Yes?
No, I was still thinking.
What are you thinking?
He's writing it as the Q1 through QK there, and he's just removing a Q each time.
So we assume that every natural number up to N has, smaller than N, has a unique prime factorization.
All right.
So we take now N. And write it as, we know it's a product of primes.
Right, because we showed it in the
right. So, possibly, there are two different ways of writing it as a prime.
Which is P and Q.
Right. So then we say that one of the factors amended P1 must be equal to one of the QJs.
And then we remove that.
We remove them.
Right.
We end up with something smaller.
Okay, by our assumption that is divisible by primes.
Right. Okay. I mean, we wrote it as a product of primes, so you can just omit this one factor, right?
So
you don't really divide, you just omit the factor. So you end up with smaller numbers. Graph factorization would be unique.
Okay.
So maybe if you reformulated this in terms of the integers, then there is some ambiguity. Namely, there is a possible factor of plus and minus.
Yeah, one. Which one has it in?
Now, one context in which you like to use it, and where it's very important, is this guy.
Is that the step function?
No. This is polynomials. In one variable. Your variable.
Any degree, or all degrees, is that what you're doing?
Any degree. Okay, so you can add them. Yeah, you can add and multiply them, right? So in many ways, they behave like a number system. So in Z units, that's kind of fine as well. So units means things that have multiplicative inverses. So unit means has multiplicative inverse. Okay, minus one times minus one is plus one. In here, you have more units. So, R minus 0 is units in Rx, right? Because if you take any constant that's not 0, your number, you can divide by the constant. You can divide with the inverse of that number and you get 1. So, can you tell me some primes?
3.
So when I talk about primes, I would say it's a product up to units.
From 1?
Right. Up to, I mean, I don't care about units.
Yeah, but you're setting a reference point, right? Up to units from 1. 3 is up.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, no, what I mean is 5 as a polynomial is not a prime. 5 is a unit because I can divide by 5 in the real numbers.
But as a polynomial would...
But if I write x plus 1, I cannot write this as...
A prime?
A product of other...
Primes.
Polynomials. I mean, I could write it...
X
as
plus x.
1 half 2x plus 2.
Yeah, sure.
Then I don't care about it because 2 is a unit.
Okay.
So as up here I would say plus minus 2 is the same thing, right? 2 is a prime, even if I can write it as minus 1 times minus 2.
Yes. Can you re-explain the idea of a unit?
Units are elements that have multiplicative inverses. So there is something that we can multiply with and we get 1. And 1 is this universal thing, if you multiply with 1, nothing changes.
So would the multiplicative inverse of 5 be 1 over 5?
Right.
Okay.
Because we are here in the real numbers, we are not in the integers.
I see.
Sure.
But we're in the integers, there's no such thing as...
A multiplicative inverse.
Where they divide it.
I see. So, if you factor polynomials, maybe you make them unique. You say the leading coefficient is 1. So if you go up to units, then you take out the ambiguity by saying the leading coefficient is 1. Right? The highest, the coefficient of the highest degree term, if this is forced as 1, you cannot multiply with units anymore.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
The example.
Yeah. Come on, like you can't even see that. Like what?
So if I write the
right on the left, or
x squared minus 1. You say this is x plus 1, x minus 1, right?
Yep.
Well, I could write also this is 2x plus 2 times 1 half x minus 1 half, right? So I factored my polynomial in two different ways. If I force the coefficient of the leading term to be 1,
oh, okay, right.
Then there is only one factorization, right? So at some point when you do partial fraction decomposition in calculus 2. Calculus 2, partial fraction decomposition.
Yep.
3 years ago.
There you use that in here. The primes are all of degree 1 and 2. Okay, they are, if you take x squared plus 1, that's, you cannot decompose it, right?
Yeah, imaginary stuff.
It's irreducible.
Yeah.
They say it's a prime. Primes are things that cannot be written as, in this case, polynomials of lower degree.
So you're just saying that anything where the power is 3 or greater, then it's not a prime.
Correct. Every polynomial of degree 3 is divisible as a zero. Right, that's the intermediate value theorem. But what you learn at some point.
Oh, you're guaranteed a zero.
Oh, the complex number is.
That's what you're saying, right? If the degree is like 3 or whatever, you're guaranteed a zero.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, for degree 4, you would have to show something.
Oh. But for an odd degree, you know
odd degree,
how the ends.
It follows by the intermediate value theorem because you have large.
Exactly, yeah. But even degrees is both the same way.
So, but you show that, I mean, there's a famous theorem, the fundamental theorem of algebra, that every polynomial factors into degree 1 terms over the complex numbers.
Yeah. It is complex.
And then you can combine, if you start out with a real polynomial, you can combine one of the linear factors and the conjugate to get a degree 2 term. Because you can always get down to degree 2 terms. So the unique factorization of polynomials into irreducible ones, which here means degree 1 and 2, will be unique up to multiplication with units. And the point is, your Euclidean division algorithm works the same way.
Is that the division algorithm? I feel like I've seen that before.
You want to divide with remainder, right?
Yeah.
The only thing for the numbers, we had the size of the number, the absolute value. If we ignore units here, the question is one of degree. So you do long division of polynomials to find your greatest common divisor.
So we're going to find the GCD of a polynomial or whatever?
If you have two polynomials, yeah. Right, on the find the greatest common divisor.
Yeah.
We just do long division.
Isn't that the division algorithm? To find the greatest GCD? That's what it is, right? Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so, but it did upset a few people and people got confused. And when you try to prove Fermat's last theorem, third theorem, it did show up as one of the early misleading thoughts.
That's the Wilkes dude. That's the Wilkes dude, right? Or something like that. He proved it in 95 or 94.
Wiles.
He had an error and then he had to redo it, yeah?
It wasn't that bad. Oh. He did a tremendous job. But generally, prime decompositions are not unique. It depends on the number system. For the integers, we're fine. And this interlude here with the polynomial ring, the ring of R of X, all the polynomials. That was just to give you another example where you have unique prime factorization. And the primes will be polynomials of degree 1 and 2.
So what you're saying is this, for other systems or whatever, it's not going to be unique.
Right.
Okay.
So let's look at some system. And
I kind of don't understand what you mean by when you say ring.
That's
a set of
fancy terminology.
Ring is like an algebra.
Okay.
This is actually an algebra. It's not. Ring means I can add, I can multiply, but I don't have multiplicative inverses.
Which we don't in the integers. We've established that, right?
The integers, we don't have it.
Yeah.
And in R of X, you don't have it. Because if you take X squared plus 1, there's no polynomial you can multiply with to get 1. So what's the weevil of it go up?
Okay.
Couldn't you just multiply?
So is just
one over
the
X
name
plus one?
For one of those systems of axioms in abstract algebra. Field, you have multiplicative inverses. Ring, you don't.
So a field would be something like rational numbers?
Right. Okay. Or real numbers or complex numbers. So what we might take is C, and you associate the square root of negative 5. So this by itself is all things of the form a plus b times square root of negative 5, where a and b are integers. So we can add them. You know the complex numbers that won't bother you. Take a prime minus 5b prime plus ab prime plus a prime b times square root of negative 5. So if I add two numbers of this kind, I end up with a number of this form. I multiply them, I also get a number of this form. Like this one is an integer. So this set has addition and multiplication, and it's closed under those operations.
Sure.
And addition and multiplication are associated, right? And they are commutative. But you can interchange the order.
Yes.
No problem. We have a zero.
Oh, if you add zero, you get the same thing. You multiply by zero, you get zero.
Which is zero plus zero times square root of negative 5. If you add that, nothing happens.
Sure.
And the 1, which is 1 plus 0 times square root of negative 5. But if you make this a 1 and this 0, you end up with a here and b there. And you have distributive laws. And additive inverses.
This is like all of our axioms or something?
Right. In fact, what you could think of is that this one here is a subset of the complex numbers.
Yeah, where the complex part is set to zero or something.
No, it's not, because here.
Yeah, the root negative 5.
If you like, you write this as a
plus
5 times I times square root of 5. Right?
Okay.
Yeah. So the imaginary part is not zero. Okay. And I claim prime factorization is not unique.
So there's like different ways that we can write a certain thing.
So,
could you have to show one example?
Yeah,
let's make up some. I mean, the easiest case would be
if you take
6 plus square root of negative 5 and multiply it with 6 minus this. What do you get?
36. Is that 36 plus 5? Oh, shit.
Yeah. Oh, okay. That's fast.
What?
Yes.
So I go 11 as a product of two other numbers. Okay, so in this case, I haven't shown that we have different prime factorizations, but what I did show is that the idea of prime doesn't quite work anymore, right? But
do you get how he got that? He uses definition over there on the second line.
Where's that? Oh, I see.
That's the only way I can think that he got that.
But then,
I don't know if that works out, though.
I didn't quite understand why our idea of prime doesn't work anymore.
I mean, 11 is not a prime anymore. I wrote it as a product of two others.
Two other primes.
The product. Two other numbers. I haven't shown that these are primes.
Okay.
They could factor further.
Losing me here. Losing me.
We made it pretty far.
Yeah. 50 minutes in. I think we gotta buy him a pipe. Take break in between, yeah. Minus 5, okay. Negative 4.
So then let's take 1 plus, well, let's make it this, yeah. 1 plus square root of negative 5, and then minus 1 plus square root of negative 5. This is 4, right?
1 times 1 minus.
Yeah. Yep. I only multiplied this with negative 1.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So I was taking your clue.
I'm using that over there, right?
Modified my example a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
No. Nothing.
So this one is also 2 times 2, right?
Sure.
So the question is, are these one plus square root of negative 5 and minus 1 plus square root of negative 5 times? Okay, if you can show that, then you have 2 different prime factorizations for the same number, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I see it. For 4, right?
Right, okay.
I don't know.
So how about, are they primes or not?
50-50, yes. Yes. How do you determine if, I'd like to say 2 is a prime, right? But how do you determine, huh?
Why is 2 a prime?
Because we've established that earlier.
But 11 was not a prime, right?
To me, 11 is a prime, bro.
11 is not a prime, right? We wrote it as a product.
Ooh. We're in Doberman land. 11 isn't prime, 2 is prime.
In this space, it's a prime.
It's right. In this space, it's not a prime. 11 is not a prime.
It's not a prime. Yeah,
it's 11 is not a prime. So it is an argument. We learned that 2 is a prime. Doesn't really hold water, right?
Doesn't hold water. Like that.
You have to prove it.
Yeah, it holds beer.
Okay. So, let me make advertisement for a really nice couch. So we have Z associated square root of negative 5. And you take a map. Inappropriately, this map is called N.
I want a square.
No, no, it should have the property so that N of A times B is N of A. So this map should be multiplicative. So if something factors here, it will factor here. That's what's good. So if it does not factor here, it will not factor.
Sure. What would that map look? I mean, how would you represent root negative 5 in terms of
value?
No. Somebody else.
So I suggest. N of x plus y times square root of negative 5 is maybe x squared plus 5 y squared.
I never thought of that.
What?
I think that's just a suggestion for a map.
That's a suggestion.
Okay.
Certainly, it will take any number here and map it to a number here, right?
Yeah, you get an integer back.
Right. Is it multiplicative?
Does it have a multiplicative inverse?
No, no, but this property.
That is multiplicative, right?
So if you take n of x plus y square root of negative 5 and multiply with x prime plus y prime square root of negative 5. So this would be x, x prime. Minus 5 y, y prime, right? Plus x y prime plus x prime y times greater than the
negative five.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So we should take this square and add 5 times this square, right? And so the question is, and I think this is right, is this the same as n of x plus square root of negative 5y and x prime y prime square root of negative 5. So you match this out. So this one here will
square
be x squared plus 5y squared. This one would be x prime
squared
plus 5 times
y
prime
squared. No, the 5's not in the square though.
Squared. And you have to work this one out. But I think that one is right. But the point is now n of 2 is four, right?
Two squared.
And that's
is that prime is 4 prime?
With this definition, n of 2 is 4.
Okay. And that has a unique.
So 4 is not alpha times beta. If you wanted to decompose it, you have to decompose 4. But 2 doesn't show up in this way. You can never get 2.
Oh.
Right? Because this is 0 or
one.
Maybe 1 or so. But this one is
0, 5.
This one cannot
one.
Be 2 by itself.
Yeah.
And this one will be at least 5.
Minimum. Well, why is 0
equal to
0?
It's always square, right? Okay.
Yep.
So it's 0 or at least 5.
So it is a prime.
So this one will be a prime. And for these guys here, we get 6, right? If you work this out. X and Y are both 1.
Mm.
So you get 6.
You can get 6 with that though, right? If X is 1 and Y is 1.
Right, but only with these numbers. No other ones.
So they are primes?
They are primes.
Oh, cool.
So the point is, if you do Euclidean division algorithm in the integers, you always come up with smaller numbers. But if you go into the complex numbers, things are not linearly ordered. So when you do division, you don't get a statement about order.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
In the complex numbers, or in those Gaussian integers, with this object as the associated square root of negative 5, if you, they sit in the complex numbers, and the complex numbers are not linearly ordered. Yeah. Right, they are all over the place. They're in the paint.
Yeah.
So if you tried any division algorithm, it does not reduce something that will lead you to some end. When you divide polynomials, the degree drops until you get the smallest possible degree.
Mm.
When we did Euclidean division algorithm, in each step we could make sure that the remainder gets smaller.
Yeah.
But in the complex numbers, we don't have a linear order. So the techniques and the Euclidean division algorithm is going to fail us.
Yeah.
So it's not surprising that when the Euclidean division algorithm fails, uniqueness of prime factorization fails. Okay, so after some caution about mathematics and that you have to prove things and they are only true under nice circumstances. This should be enough. But you can, yeah, try and check that map. Show that for homework, show that n is multiplicative.
Show that n is multiplicative.
So just do the algebra.
Yeah, just do the algebra.
So basically when you, where that question mark is, we just start back from there and try to show it goes always to that bottom.
Well, I wrote it out here, right? And in this particular, this is what we want for this particular map. But so why would that be true?
Why would that be true?
We have multiplication in this thing, though.
If you think of the norm in the complex numbers, the length of a complex number, right? Norm.
Never heard of it before.
You don't know the norm?
Is that the distance from like the origin or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Euclidean distance from the origin.
Okay.
Okay. Square.
Mm-hmm.
This is the formula for the square of the distance.
The formula, the x plus y square root of 5, that's the
yes.
Okay.
This one. Right, I mean, for complex numbers, how do you get the absolute value? What's the length of this?
There you go.
Right. So we did exactly this formula here. I mean, we took the square of it. Okay, if you took radicals, we don't stay in the integers. And
I thought it was gonna be an easy homework, but I guess not.
Oh, is it not? You don't have to, wait, so you don't have to just do the algebra from the end?
You can just do the edge.
Okay.
But what I was saying is, if you had a little background,
oh.
If you understood the complex numbers, if you took linear algebra, you would know.
Why are you looking at me? You're taking it right now.
I don't think we touched on this.
Oh, you didn't have my professor this way.
Did you take linear algebra?
Yeah.
When you do inner products?
No way.
Maybe inner product defines a norm for you.
Yeah, I don't think we talked about that.
Nope.
What was it?
We didn't go to complex.
He has Olga.
We're still talking about real numbers.
He has Olga.
You didn't do enough products.
Is that the dot product?
Yeah.
Okay, alright, okay. Yes.
And every dot product or inner product defines a norm for you, an idea of length, right?
Yes.
The length of X.
Just agree with him.
Yes. It does.
Is X dot X radical, right?
Yeah.
And here we use the square of it. So you can take linear factors out of, not linear factors out, you, I mean, this, the norm is multiplicative, so this will be multiplicative.
Okay.
All right.
So
you can work out an argument by central algebra, but otherwise you can refer to the complex numbers and say, obviously, we know that's true.
That's what I'm going to put around my paper then. Obviously, this is true. I will refer you to the complex numbers.
Okay. See you Friday.